20-30 times in a day. So the volume of blood in an average adult is approximately 5 liters. So this means 20-30 times a day. So that means between 200 and 300 liters. So that's a lot of water that is filtered here, and we have mechanisms to reabsorb this water, okay? Approximately 99% of the water that we filter, out here, is reabsorbed, and it's brought back to the blood vessels. And then there are, remember that this filtration, the filtration occurs by size of the molecules, okay? Very small molecules are going to get through this barrier, and big molecules are not going to be able to cross these pores that you find in the glomerular capsule and the glomerulus. So that's a problem because we have molecules that we want to get rid of that are really big, right? And we have molecules that we want to keep that are really small. So besides filtration, we have other renal processes, two of them actually. So we have secretion, to get rid of molecules that we don't want in our blood, but they are too big to be filtered. And we have absorption, to bring back to the blood vessels all these molecules that are filtered here because they are too small, but we need to conserve among these molecules. So we have different ions, water, and other things that we don't want to excrete. So once the process of filtration, secretion, and absorption have occurred, we end up with the definitive urine that is going to be excreted. And for any particular molecule that you think about, you can calculate the rate of excretion as the rate of filtration plus the rate of secretion minus the rate of absorption. All right, then we went through each one of these processes in more detail. So we have here in this picture, I explained this in 15 minutes or so. So in the process of filtration, you have different pressures favoring filtration or opposing filtration. And we discussed those. Overall, the forces favoring filtration are larger than the forces opposing filtration, and this results in a net glomerular filtration pressure, which is the sum of these pressures here. And in normal conditions, it's approximately 16 millimeters of mercury, which is not super high, but at least it makes ensures that all the blood is going to be filtered, okay? Instead of bringing the pre-urine back to the blood vessels, which is something that obviously we don't want, right? So that would be the process of filtration, and then, which is based on this equation, dynamics of fluids, okay? We have seen that many, many times when we talked about blood, about air, yeah? We discussed this for the cardiovascular system, for the respiratory system, and also for the urinary system, okay? And the processes of absorption and secretion happen. We can do those using any of these mechanisms. And which mechanism do we use? It depends on the biochemical nature of the molecule that we want to transport, okay? So for nonpolar small molecules, we are gonna use diffusion through lipid bilayer. For big molecules, we're going to use facilitated diffusion, and sometimes we want to recover ions or recover different things, and we need to use energy to do that. So then we're going to use primary active transport or secondary active transport. So it depends on which is the molecule that you want to transport. You're going to use one system or another. One of the most important, so we were talking about water balance, right? So we are concerned about water in this case, and water moves through membranes, across membranes, using a process that we call osmosis, which is basically diffusion, okay? And remember that since this is basically diffusion, there were two characteristics of diffusion. molecules move from high concentration to low concentration, and you don't need to use energy, right? So when we have a solution of water plus other things, plus different kinds of solids, you have a concentration of the solids in the solution, and automatically you have a concentration of water in the solution. And remember, this has to be very clear for you, whenever you increase the concentration of the solids, you automatically decrease the concentration of water, and the opposite. When you decrease the concentration of solids, you increase the concentration of water, okay? If you understand that, then you shouldn't have any problem understanding osmosis, because water is gonna move from high concentration to low concentration, okay? Until there is an equilibrium in which concentrations of solids and water are the same, okay? So this is the situation that occurs when you have a membrane that is permeable to both the solid and water, okay? This ends up in a situation at equilibrium in which you have the same concentrations of solids and water in both compartments, and also there are no changes in volume. But in the body, that's not the scenario that you see. So in cells and in the liquid compartments of the body in general, this membrane is not permeable to anything, okay? So the membrane is permeable to water most of the time, but it's not permeable to many solids, okay? So only water can move from high concentration to low concentration, and when this occurs, this is what happens, okay? You cannot stop diffusion of water, but since you cannot move the molecules of solute, this results at equilibrium in a change in the volumes of the compartments, okay? I hope nobody has any problem with that, right? So do you understand that very well? We discussed this at the beginning of the semester, okay? In exam 4, probably there is going to be a question about this, right? So I want to make sure that you all understand. Okay, so those are the basics, and then we talked about the situation in which we have a decrease in the volume of water in the body. Remember, we do not have sensory receptors that detect volume. That would be impossible, okay? There is no way that a cell can detect the entire volume of water in the body. But decreases in the volume of water are associated with other things. For example, a decrease in blood pressure. An increase in the concentration of solids, because you have less water, yeah? You have the same amount of solids, but they are dissolved in a lower volume of water, then the concentration of solids increases. What's going to happen with the concentration of water? It will decrease, right? So a decrease in the volume of water is associated with a decreasing pressure and an increase in osmolarity. And those are things that sensory receptors can detect. And when the sensory receptors send this information to the central nervous system, so there are a series of responses to this decreasing volume. So we activate the sympathetic, so the central nervous system sends messages to the effectors using the sympathetic nervous system. And the sympathetic nervous system stimulates the renin-angiotensin system. Remember that you have the liver secreting angiotensinogen, which is an inactive form of an enzyme that needs renin to be transformed into angiotensin II, which is the active compound, okay? Renin is secreted by the juxtaglomerular complex, which is in the kidney also. It's next to the proximal convoluted tubules. And once you have angiotensin II stimulates the adrenal cortex to secrete aldosterone. And aldosterone is going, remember that aldosterone, what it does is to stimulate the activity of the sodium potassium ATPase in the cells that form the wall of the tubes in the nephrons. So you're going to, when you stimulate the activity of the sodium potassium ATPase, you're going to pump sodium from the inside of the tubule to the blood vessels, and water will follow the movement of sodium, okay? The sympathetic nervous system also constricts the afferent arteriole, which results in a decrease in the glomerular filtration rate. When you constrict an arteriole, then the flow of blood going through this arteriole is lower, and this means that you're going to filter less volume of blood, which is good because you have a decreased volume of blood, then you want to conserve as much blood as you can, right? So you're going to filter this blood at a lower rate, okay? So you have these two things combined, okay? Lowering glomerular filtration rate and pumping sodium out to the blood vessels, so water will follow it, okay? And this is regulated by aldosterone. This process here is regulated by aldosterone. This process here is controlled by the central nervous system using the sympathetic nervous system, okay? The central nervous system, the hypothalamus, is this region of the central nervous system that is mainly going to control all this. The hypothalamus secretes this hormone, the antidiuretic hormone, which also influences the cells in the collecting duct. And what happens is that the antidiuretic hormone, what it does is to make the epithelium of the collecting duct more permeable, so then water can move to the blood vessels. When you don't secrete this hormone, then the epithelium of the collecting tubule is very impermeable, and then all the water that is inside the collecting tubule is going to be excreted in the urine, okay? You cannot recover any water, all right? Now, all these responses result in an increase in blood volume, right? Because you are putting water into the blood vessels, right? So the red arrow is because these responses, they go against the stimulus. The stimulus is a decrease in blood volume. So we are talking about a negative feedback loop, okay? And here you have the mechanism of action of aldosterone. So you have the epithelial cells in the tubules, you have a blood vessel, you have the tubular lumen, so the urine will go through here. When you pump this sodium to the interstitial fluid, then you're going to increase osmolarity here, and then water is gonna move. You're gonna increase osmolarity here, you're gonna decrease osmolarity here because you're taking sodium ions from the tubular lumen, and then water is gonna follow this difference in concentration, right? So if you increase osmolarity here, this means that you're going to decrease the concentration of water, right? If the concentration of water is higher here than here, then the water is gonna move from here to here, right? And then sodium and water are going to move by bulk flow into the blood vessels, okay? This is mediated by aldosterone. Aldosterone is telling the 7-potassium ATPase to work harder, okay? If there is no aldosterone, the activity of the 7-potassium ATPase is very low, okay? And then you don't have this movement of water, right? Okay? So this is what we covered a couple of weeks ago. Do you have any questions about that? You see the big picture? Yeah. And I ended up here, so I'm sure that you have all looked at this picture last week. Yeah, right. So this is a diagram that explains what we call the counter current multiplier system of urine, of concentration of urine. So let's see. I'm gonna start with this is a nephron, and here you have the blood vessels, the glomerulus. Okay. Well, it turns out that in normal conditions, the concentration of the blood and the interstitial fluid, which is pretty much the same, is 300 million smalls, okay? That's the normal concentration of in blood and interstitial fluid. When you filter the blood here, basically what you're doing is the blood is just moving from the capillaries into the renal capsule, all right? And of course the composition of this filtrate is a bit different than the composition of the blood, but the concentration doesn't change that much. So you're gonna have fluid here with a concentration of 300 millismoles, okay? I'm not gonna write down the units anymore, okay? I'm just gonna write down the number from now on as it's there. So then you're gonna have the different tubes. I'm gonna try to use the same ones here. So okay, you're gonna have the proximal convoluted tubule. Then the nephron, wait, so from here. Then the nephron loop. The distal convoluted tubule, and this ends up in the collecting duct. Okay, that's what you have for one nephron. Remember that we have millions of nephrons, so that merge in the collecting duct. Okay. All right. So, if let's suppose that the epithelium of the tubules is completely impermeable, okay? So that you have what it filter here is what you excrete, all right? Now, what would be the concentration of the filtrate in the proximal convoluted tubule? Assuming that the epithelium is completely impermeable and there is nothing going in and nothing going out, what would be the concentration here?
300.
And what would be the concentration here? 300. Here as well, here as well. And what would be the concentration of the urine? 300. All right? This is very diluted. This is not a very high concentration at all. All right? Now, there is nothing wrong in excreting urine that is pretty diluted. The only problem is that you're going to lose a lot of water. Okay? So, and we cannot really afford that. We cannot lose like liters and liters of water per day, yeah? Because then this will mean that we will need to drink or regain these X liters of water per day. Animals don't do that, yeah? We are animals, whether you like it or not, and in nature, I don't know, birds, mammals, they spend their time doing things that go towards survival and reproduction. So all the individuals, they want to increase their reproductive success, they want to survive to increase their reproductive success, right? So if you are a bird and you excrete really diluted urine, then you will need to spend a long time finding sources of water to replenish your body water. If you spend like, let's say, 3 hours just trying to find and drinking water, then this means that you have 3 hours less to forage, reproduce, do stuff that actually is going to increase your reproductive success, right? The same with mammals, yeah? Now, there are environments in which this is more crucial than others, right? So if you're a mammal that lives in a desert, so in a desert it's good that you don't lose a lot of water. If you live in Ohio, which is relatively humid, then you can lose more water. It doesn't matter because you have lots of water available. But if you live in a really hyper-arid desert, sources of water, of drinking water, are really scarce, right? So maybe they are absent. Maybe you don't find water in miles and miles and miles. So you cannot lose a lot of water because you cannot afford it. Yeah. So in general, we want to conserve as much water as we can. Yeah. Now, If we excrete urine at this concentration, the problem is that we are going to need liters and liters of water, and we're going to lose liters and liters of water every day. Okay? So we need a mechanism to concentrate this urine. So we excrete the same amount of solute, right, or the same amount of particles that we want to excrete, but with using a much smaller volume of water. Okay. So how do we do that? How do we conserve water? Well, we use energy. Okay. So if we don't do anything about it, we're gonna lose a lot of water. So if we need to do something about it, then we need to put some energy in this process. Okay. And what we do is, in some regions of the tube, we're going to have pumps that are going to send ions from the inside of the tube to the interstitial space. Okay? And we have these pumps located here in the nephron loop, but not just anywhere, so only the ascending loop of the nephron loop. Okay? Now, let's see. I think I'm gonna use different colors, so more or less like there. So if you have pumps in the ascending tube, okay, here, but not here, all right? So what you're going to do is to pump these ions out, all right? From the inside of the tube, out. Okay, now, let's imagine that we start here. And then you get the urine coming at 300 here. Now, what happens when you pump ions out? What happens with this number? It's going to increase. Why?
Oh, no. Yeah. Well,
why?
So if you're pumping sodium chloride out, the water is going to follow it, so there's going to be...
No. This is just pumping ions out. Forget about the water so far.
Okay.
So what's going to happen when you pump sodium chloride out at this level? And forget about the numbers here, okay? We're going to get to these numbers in a minute, but then... So, you start with an epithelium that is impermeable to water and solids, okay? And now you add these pumps that can only move solids out. So you get urine at 300 milliosmoles. When you get here, you're pumping ions out. What do you think is gonna happen with the concentration of solids?
Decrease,
right? And maybe you're gonna get, after a couple of pumps, I don't know, maybe you get to 200, let's say. And two more pumps, you get to... So, try not to write down anything because this is gonna change a lot. So, pay attention to what I'm saying, and if you understand the process, then you should be able to redo this after a little bit of thought. So, let's suppose that after this is 150, and after that, you get to 100, okay? Well, you might think, okay, so this guy is telling me that we're interested in concentrating the urine, and what we're doing is diluting the urine even more. A concentration of 100 is almost nothing. If you excrete urine that has a concentration of 100 milliosmoles, you're pretty much peeing almost pure water, yeah? So, obviously, there are more things going on. Let's see. I'm going to draw these like thicker, so then you can see the numbers. All right, so we start with this, so we add these pumps, all right? So then, if we add these pumps, what we are doing is to decrease the concentration of the urine here, right? Now, What do you think is originally the concentration of the extracellular fluid? The same as in the blood, okay? So this concentration is going to be 300. Now, when we are pumping solids out, so what do you think happens with this concentration here? Increases, right? So let's say that this increases to 500. So after you're pumping all the solids out, let's suppose that this goes to 500. Well, actually, that would be 400. That would be, oops, that would be 450, that would be 500. Okay? And remember that the concentration here is 300. But we were assuming that the epithelium is completely impermeable, right? So you cannot move water or solids. Well, now let's suppose that here you make this epithelium permeable to water, just water, okay? So if you can move water from this tube here or the opposite, right? If water can move in and out of this tube, what do you think is gonna happen in that situation? So you have a higher concentration of solids here, 400, and down here, 300, 450, 300, 500, 300, right? Here you can only move water now, okay, in this section of the tube. If you can only move water, where do you think the concentration of water is higher, here or here? Inside the tube or outside the tube? The concentration of water, where is it higher? In the tube. So the concentration of water will be higher here than here, right? Where, if you can only move water, where do you think the water will go? From the tube to the outside or from the outside back to the tube? From the tube to the outside, right? So the water, I'm going to use blue. Water is gonna move in this direction because you pump these solids here, right? Then you are changing the concentration of solids here. If you are changing the concentration of solids, automatically you are changing the concentration of water, but in the opposite direction, right? And if you can only move water here, then the water is gonna move, yeah? By osmosis. And then when the water moves outside, what's gonna happen with this concentration? It will go down, but what's gonna happen with this concentration? It will go up, okay? And this is gonna happen until the concentrations equilibrate, okay? And let's suppose that at equilibrium, the concentration is 400 in both, okay? So then now you're gonna have 400 and the concentrations are going to equilibrate between the inside and the outside, and now you're gonna have 400 here and 400 here, 400, 400, 400, 400, yeah. Okay? Well, the thing is that now you have urine that comes at a higher concentration, so this number is not going to be 300. This number is gonna be 400, right? You have to imagine this as a continuous flow, right? Because you are filtering the blood there all the time. So this is not just, this fluid is not just there. So this fluid is moving, yeah? Okay, now you have a concentration of 400. When you pump solids from here, yeah? What are you doing with the concentration here? Increase. So let's say that instead of 400, now you increase it to, let's say, 600. And when you increase this one to 600, what's gonna happen with the concentration here? It's gonna go down from 400 to 200, let's say. Yeah? Same again, right? Then you're gonna have, like here, you're gonna have 650, and here you're gonna have 700, I don't know. What's gonna happen with the water in the tube here? Going to move from here to here, right? Because the concentration of water now is higher here than here. When you move the concentration of water from here to here, when you reach equilibrium, these two concentrations are the same, yeah, and let's say that the equilibrium is at 650. Okay, now you went from 400 to 650. And here you have 650. And then what's going to happen? This concentration of urine, instead of 400, because you have the urine coming from here, it's going to be 650. And then you continue pumping ions over there. You see how we can increase the concentration of solutes in the urine? Do you understand this process? The key here is to understand that you have ion pumps here, but not here. If you had ion pumps here, then you're screwing up the whole mechanism, right? And this epithelium here is permeable to water, okay? But not this one, because if this one is permeable to water, what's gonna happen? The water is gonna move in, yeah? Okay? Yeah.
What type of ion pumps are those?
So, those are proteins similar to the sodium potassium ATPases. So this is an example of what kind of transport of molecule?
Active transport.
Active transport through proteins, but active transport requires proteins always, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And those are ion pumps. So those are proteins that will pump specific ions in and out. It's the same kind of protein as the sodium potassium ATPase, okay? All right, now we have, well, you have a mechanism that will concentrate urine, okay? Now, you start with the filtrate at 300, which is more or less the same as the concentration in the blood and the extracellular fluid. Then, in the proximal convoluted tubule, you still have 300. Here, you increase the concentration to whatever, yeah? And you are going to increase this concentration. But here, since you have all the ion pumps working, then you are going to decrease the concentration. And notice that the urine that leaves this tube, the nephron loop, is still very diluted, yeah? So we have done a lot here. We have increased the concentration here. But once the urine goes in this direction, then we are decreasing the concentration. So this, at first sight, is like if we are not doing anything, right? We are spending energy for nothing because we are concentrating the urine here, but actually we are diluting the urine here, right? Let's see what happens in the distal convoluted tubule. So you have a concentration. If you don't do anything about it, then the concentration in the distal convoluted tubule would be 100, and the concentration in the collecting duct would be 100 as well. And actually, not only you are not concentrating the urine, you are making things worse. Well, the important thing here is that we also have ion pumps in the distal convoluted tubule, okay? That are going to concentrate this urine. But just a bit, so you can see that the ion pumps here are going to concentrate the urine back to 300, okay? So then you're gonna have a urine concentration of 300 here, which is the same as the concentration of the blood and the extracellular fluid. So actually, it's the same situation as before. You haven't gained anything. The only thing, you have lost things because you have to spend energy to do this, to bring the urine back to 300. So that doesn't make any sense. Well, what you can see is that in the collecting duct is permeable to water, and remember that this depends on which hormone?
The ADH.
ADH, the antidiuretic hormone, okay? The secretion of this hormone is going to control the permeability of the collecting duct. And you have a few ion pumps too, to adjust a bit the concentration here, but we'll talk about those later. Now, The important thing here is that what you can see here, so those are the concentrations at equilibrium, right? So this is if you let the system equilibrate. But since the fluid is moving continuously, right, you're gonna have a lower concentration here, and then the concentration gradient is going to increase as you move the urine into the descending limb of the nephron loop. Okay, so you have the urine coming at 300. So the urine here would be 300. And the concentration here, and I'm going to use those numbers now. So the concentration here is going to be 600, 900, 1200, and I think here's 1400. There is a gradient, right? You're bringing the urine at 300 from here, right? And then as you go down in the nephron loop, then the concentration is going to increase. This is a gradient, okay? It increases slowly from 300 up to 1400, okay? And at equilibrium, the concentration here in the extracellular space is going to be the same as here, right? So then you're gonna have 600, so you're gonna have 300, 600, 900, 1200, 1400. Then the urine gets here at a concentration of 1400, and since here you are pumping the ions out, then the concentration is going to do the opposite as here. So as you go up, it's going to decrease, right? This is why you have the same, more or less the same numbers over there. So you have 1,000, 700, 400, 100, okay? Then you have 100 here, but since you have ion pumps here, you bring the concentration of the urine back to 300, okay? Do you understand this so far? Are you following me? Okay. Now, this is interstitial space as well, right? You have, that is filled in with extracellular fluid. And this extracellular fluid is surrounding pretty much everything, right? And then what do you think the concentration here is going to be? It's going to be the same as the concentration here, right? Because at equilibrium, these concentrations are going to be the same. So you're going to have a concentration of 1400 here because the concentration here is 1400, right? I'm using those numbers. You're going to have 1200, you're going to have 900, 600, 300. Yeah? That would be the concentration in the extracellular fluid. Okay? Now, let's go back to the urine. You increase the concentration of the urine from 100 to 300 here. And now you have urine coming through here at 300. So, what's going to happen? Is there going to be any movement of water or solids? No, because the concentrations are the same here and here, right? But when you reach this point, what's going to happen?
Is it water or like solid?
So what do you think? Is solid going to be moved or water? Water, because in this case you have an epithelium that is only permeable or impermeable to water, okay? So, since the concentration of water is, so you're gonna move water out to here, yeah? And then these concentrations are going to equilibrate, okay? And then you're gonna have 600 here. As you go down, this is gonna be 900 because you're gonna have this movement of water. This is going to be 1200, this is going to be 1400. And since this loop is that long, yeah, so, 1 second. Since this loop is that long, if it were longer, you could reach a higher concentration, right? But since this loop is that long, the maximum concentration that we can get is 1400. So, this is the maximum concentration of urine that we can produce in humans, okay? There are other animals that can produce more concentrated urine, some animals that cannot concentrate the urine as much as we do, all right? And this is the concentration of urine that you're gonna excrete, okay? This movement of water is going to be based on the action of ADH, all right? So if you secrete ADH, then you're gonna make the epithelium more permeable to water, and then water is gonna get out. If you don't secrete ADH, the epithelium is going to be impermeable, and then what do you think is going to be the concentration of urine? 300. Okay? And well, you have degrees in between. So you can control how much water you wanna get out of the collecting duct to the extracellular space. What was your question?
You answered it.
Okay. Now, all this water that gets out is going to dilute this, right? It's going to dilute the extracellular space, right? So if you get a lot of water out of here, then this is not going to be 600 anymore, this is going to be like, let's say 400. Or depending on the amount of water that you move out, this is going to be 300 or 200. Well, the thing is that we have blood vessels.
I'm gonna use this.
So we have blood vessels that run parallel to the tubes, and you could see that here. These blood vessels that run parallel to the tubes are going to take all this extra water. And these concentrations are going to be maintained. Because remember that those are fluids that are constantly circulating, yeah? So if you don't have these fluids circulating, you just have these fluids standing there inside the tubes and outside of the tubes, eventually the concentrations are going to equilibrate, okay? But these fluids are in constant circulation, right? So all this water that we, if you think about it, this is a mechanism of reabsorption of water, right? All this water that we are reabsorbing, that we filtrated in the first place, we need to bring this water back into the blood vessels, right? So these blood vessels that run parallel to the tubes are going to pretty much take all this water back into the bloodstream, okay? All right? Do you understand this? Are you following that? Now, do you see that it is very important that you understand osmosis, mechanism of transport across molecules, diffusion, concentration gradients, okay? That's why I insisted a lot at the beginning of the course. So the beginning of the semester, you were like, okay, so that was kind of vague, I guess. That was, you couldn't see yet what's the value of understanding all this. So I hope that, well, not just in this physiological process, but we have seen other physiological processes in which you could see that this movement of molecules across membranes has played a crucial role. Is that clear? Yeah.
Okay, this is probably a bad question, but I think I understand everything except the other side in the extracellular fluid. Why is the concentration also a gradient too? Do you know?
So you want to reach equilibrium between these two, right?
Yeah, but how is there a gradient on that side? Do you know what I mean?
On this side?
Yes.
Okay, so this is a consequence of me drawing something that is 3D in 2D.
Okay.
So this is a tube, right? But imagine it's a cylinder, and this is the extracellular fluid surrounding everything, right? It's not that this is one compartment and this is a different one.
Okay, yeah.
It's part of the same framework.
Okay, that makes 100% more sense.
Okay. Any more questions? Okay, so Now, when you take a look at this figure, then hopefully you're gonna understand this much better. But you need to have very clear osmosis, transport of molecules, right? Okay? All right, now, as I said, depending on the environmental conditions, there are some times that we need to conserve more water, sometimes that we need to lose water, okay? So we need to keep this water balance. It is as bad to have a low volume of blood as a high volume of blood, okay? So to have too much water is also bad. If you put together this with that, okay, probably this is going to make more sense now. All right, so when you pump ions and then the water moves along with the ions, what you are doing pretty much is to concentrate the urine as much as you can. So then you can conserve as much water as you can. So when you have concentrated at 1400 millimoles, that's the maximum that you can get, okay? But this means that you are excreting all the things that you need to excrete with the minimum volume of water possible. Yeah? So if you wanted to lose even less water, you will need to concentrate the urine even more. But physiologically, we cannot do that. All right? Our nephron loops are that long. There are other animals, these desert animals that I explained to you about. So these, there are rodents, yeah, that live in deserts, and their nephron loops are super long. So if a nephron loop of a human is like this, so there are rodents that have a nephron loop that is something like that. And they can concentrate urine to, I don't know, 4,000 milliosmoles instead of 14,000. This means that since they can concentrate their urine so much, they are going to save a lot of water, right? Because they are concentrating their urine, almost three times more than humans. So this means that they can save a lot of water, okay? But this is in animals that live in deserts. There are animals that live in water, for example, so fresh water animals. So the fresh water wants to move into their bodies because the fresh water is less concentrated than the fluids that the animals have. Fish that live in fresh water or other animals that live in fresh water. So these animals, they need to lose a lot of water to keep their water balance. Otherwise, they will get a lot of water and then the bad things happen too. So then they have, some of these animals, they don't even have nephron loops. You have some species of fish, and they don't have nephron loops because they don't need to concentrate their urine. So they only have the proximal and the distal convoluted tubules. And actually what they want is the opposite, to dilute their urine as much as they can to get rid of all this extra water that is coming into their bodies because they cannot help it, because the concentration of water outside is much higher than the concentration of water inside their bodies. You can, so anatomical structures like the nephron loop allow you to concentrate your urine, and moreover, then you have these mechanisms of adjustment of the concentration of water, like this, the most important would be the angiotensin, renin angiotensin aldosterone system, and ADH, which is going to regulate the permeability of the collecting duct. Okay? All right? Now, try to put these together with this, and then I hope that everything will make more sense. Okay, you don't have any more questions about this? We're gonna start with the regulation of sodium and potassium. Basically, it would be sodium, but I'll talk a bit about potassium, but not too much. And you're gonna see that there are lots of mechanisms that are very similar to the ones that we use to regulate water balance. And it will not take me that long to explain this. So again, we are talking about gains and losses, yeah? So to keep a balance. So we need to maintain our concentration of sodium, our concentration of potassium in the body, right? So it's very important that we have sodium, potassium. Without sodium and potassium, we cannot generate electrochemical gradients. Remember the mechanism of transmission of electrical signal in neurons? Involves the electrochemical gradient of sodium and potassium, right? That makes the inside of the plasma membrane more slightly negative with respect to the outside. If we didn't have sodium in our cells, we couldn't generate action potentials. We couldn't generate receptor potentials. So this means that in the homeostatic control mechanisms, we will be able to make them function. So we will be able to detect the stimuli, we will be able to make the integrating center work, etc. You know what that means. So we need to maintain the balance of sodium and potassium, the same as we need to maintain the balance of water. And we also have losses of these elements that are kind of unavoidable, okay? And here you have a few numbers. So this is in an average human. So we're talking about salt, sodium chloride, but that involves pretty much all the sodium that we lose. You can make a similar table for potassium as well. We lose approximately 8 grams a day of sodium in the urine, and a small amount of sodium in feces and when we sweat. If you add this up, it's about 8.5 grams of sodium that we lose every day. To keep the balance of sodium in the body, this means that we need to ingest at least the same amount of sodium, right? So basically, we get all the sodium that we need via the food, and you can see that we gain approximately the same amount of sodium that we lose, okay? If this doesn't happen, if we don't gain the same amount of sodium that we lose, then, or potassium for that matter, so then there are going to be things going on in our body which are not going to be nice, right? So, which is the major organ that is going to control the sodium balance? The kidney again. So here you have the anatomy of the kidney again, cortex, medulla, blah, blah, blah. And the kidney is actually formed by these tiny functional units, the nephrons. And this is, again, the structure of the nephrons, right? With the renal corpuscle, the proximal convoluted tubule, nephron loop, distal convoluted tubule, and then the urine goes to the collecting duct. There is some adjustment in the concentration, and you know this. And then we excrete the urine through here. Okay? Same processes, yeah? So in the nephrons, you have filtration, secretion, and reabsorption, right? So the thing with sodium and potassium is that they are really small ions, right? So they are going to be filtrated, no problem. So all the sodium ions that get here, they are going to be able to cross the pores of the glomeruli, of the glomerular capillaries, and they're going to be able to cross the filtration slits of the epithelium of the renal corpuscle. So the sodium is not gonna have any problem to be filtered, and then you're gonna end up with a high amount of sodium here inside the tubules, the nephron tubules. So if you want to recover some of this sodium, then what you will need to do is to reabsorb part of this sodium or all this sodium want to. Okay? all these mechanisms of filtration, absorption, secretion, they are based on the laws of the dynamics of fluids. And again, you have this equation, flow equals difference in pressure divided by resistance, and we're going to control filtration rate using these forces that favor or oppose filtration, and we can make these forces higher or lower. So we end up with what we call the net glomerular filtration pressure. This is the same as for the regulation of water, right? So if for some reason we want to, we ingested a lot of sodium and we want to get rid of a lot of sodium, one way which we can do it is to increase glomerular filtration rate. To increase glomerular filtration rate, to increase flow, one thing that you can do is to increase pressure. Another thing is to decrease resistance, or you can do both, okay? Etc. So we are gonna have different mechanisms to adjust the concentration of sodium that we have in the urine, okay? And potassium as well. And for absorption and secretion, then you have all these different mechanisms. So we are concerned about sodium. So sodium basically is going to diffuse using protein channels, but this is more typical for for neurons and cells of the nervous system, because we use this mechanism basically to generate electrical signals. And the main mechanism that we're gonna have to move sodium in the urinary system is primary active transport. So we're gonna use pumps to bring the sodium back into the blood. And we're not gonna use that much this mechanism here of diffusion, all right? And sodium and water, they are really linked in the sense that sodium is a solid, right? We don't have sodium floating around in the body, so it's usually dissolved in water. And if you want to mess up with the concentration of sodium, whether you like it or not, you're messing up with the concentration of water. So if you want to make the concentration of sodium higher, whether you like it or not, you're making the concentration of water smaller. And if you want to make the concentration of sodium smaller, you're making the concentration of water higher. You cannot do both things at the same time. So you cannot decrease both the concentration of sodium and water, or increase both the concentration of sodium and water. So every time you move a solid, then you are altering the concentration of water as well. The thing with water is that we cannot really, so we move water using proteins, and I'll talk about this on Friday, that we call aquaporins, which literally means pores where the water goes through. But we cannot really, so the water is gonna move to one compartment to another, okay? So by changing the concentration of solids, then we need to make sure that we are not changing the concentration of water too much, or at least that it's not messing up water balance, okay? So this is why you're gonna see lots of physiological processes that are common for the maintenance of water balance and the maintenance of sodium and potassium balance, okay? Because both things are usually very connected, yeah? Well, this is pretty much the same as what I explained before. So for osmosis, if the membrane is permeable to both water and solute, then you're gonna reach equilibrium without changing volume. But this is the case in biological systems. You have a membrane that is usually permeable to water but not to solids, and then you will need to change the volume of the compartments, okay? I think I'm gonna leave it here, and we will discuss two cases next on Friday. So we're gonna talk about what happens, what are the physiological response, what is the physiological response to an increase in this concentration of sodium, and what's the physiological response to a decrease in the concentration of sodium. and you will see that sodium is usually associated with water. So there are many systems that you have seen already. It would be just a reminder. Okay? Do you have any questions? All right. Let's get right.